here for the first time. Wow, outstanding. All right, so welcome. You're going to have a good time today. If you haven't already, you're going to make it better, right? So what I'm going to do for the next 30 minutes or so is I'm going to give you my perspective on what it was like to get assigned to the astronaut office, assigned to a crew, and we'll talk about what it was like flying space. We're going to finish up with a little bit of a chat about where we are today. Why is that important to you and I here on the ground? And we're going to put that in hopefully some perspective. But let's get this thing kicked off. And the only reason we have this picture of me up here is so you can see what I look like as a young man. Now, Nick mentioned my three crews. Here they are, SDS 89, 104, 117. You'll see all these folks in my little presentation here as we're going through it today. We get assigned to the missions about 9 months before flight. We start training immediately, and it can get to be pretty intense. We have about a 14-hour schedule day. That doesn't include email or any of the other stuff you got to do. About the last 3 months of that 9 months. That's what you see us doing up here, the spacewalk training, these two upper images. That's Danny on the right, that's me on the left. You'll see both of us here on the vid deck in a few minutes. We're training in what's called the Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory. It's really just a big pool. It's 200 feet long, 100 feet wide, 40 feet deep. And we can put in all the stuff that's in the space station that we're going to go out and work on. We put that as a mock-up, and that's what you see right here. That's the S3, S4 truss. That's Danny in the background, and in the foreground. And we're practicing it at least 5 times before we actually go do it for real. So we've got it pretty well fine-tuned by the time we go. Now we have all of our mock-ups and everything else back there that we do our training in back in Houston. In fact, we live and work in Houston. Most of our time is spent there, not down here, in spite of what you might think. So even though Atlantis is here, all the equipment we're going to fly in space is here, we actually spend very little time down here in that 9 months. We actually only come down here a couple of times. One of them is a kind of a big deal for us, and that's called the Terminal Countdown Demonstration Test. So on the day of launch, we're going to get in, strap in, and be able to do the countdown. So we practice that about 2 weeks before. Come down for TCDT, and then obviously we don't launch. What we do when we get to zero is we get out of the seats, unopen the hatch and the lamps, and walk down the 195 foot level as if there's an emergency. And then we hop into this thing right here. It's called the slide wire basket. And this thing's designed to take you down that wire, getting speeds of up to 60 miles an hour to get you away from the lamps in a hurry. So that's 3.5 million pounds of high explosives. And if this is going to go off, you don't want to be anywhere near it. So that's what this device is designed to do. We actually do everything we have to. Hit that paddle, which cuts that little wire, nylon cord right there. But instead of taking off down that wire, it only goes about that far. The reason is management has put a chain up right there to keep us from going anywhere. And then management, of course, has worked with astronauts before, so what you can't see is the padlock right down there. To guarantee that we don't go anywhere. And we've always wanted to write this all the crew, and we've never got a chance to write it. Only one guy, that's the current administrator of NASA. The rest of us have never had a chance because management's answer was always no, no, no. And well, finally they said, well, why not? And they said, they gave us their opinion. And it was management's considered opinion, astronauts going down that wire, hitting speeds of up to 60 miles an hour, that was way too dangerous.
The irony.
So, now, while we're back in Houston doing all that training, we actually have 700 people down here getting everything ready for flight. And that's what you see going on here. This big piece of equipment right there is the S3, S4 truss that you're going to see on the side of the station here in a little bit. That's inside that thing called a payload canister. It's going up into this part, which is called the rotating surface structure. In fact, Atlantis isn't even there yet. Next time you see that white room, which is on the 195 foot level, it's going to be attached to the side of Atlantis. So that's getting put up into position. Atlantis then rolls out. We rotate the service structure over the top of Atlantis, open the payload bay doors, slide the payload in, close it up. Now Atlantis is ready for us to show up. She's just waiting for us. We show up about 4 days before launch. Fly down in our T-38s, as you see here. Nice way to travel because we can go from Houston down here to the Cape in about 1 hour and 42 minutes. But as you can see right there, the in-flight service isn't so great. Now, on the day of launch, we get up and have breakfast, just like Al Shepard did on his first launch back in 1962. And every crew, from him all the way down to us, we get up and have breakfast. Most of us all in the same place, right here, in crew quarters. That's what you see going on. Atlantis is on the screen back there. She now has all of her propellant loaded. She's just waiting for us to go fly in space. And about 4 hours before launch, we get into these things called our launch and entry suits. And then walk out to the van.
That's cool.
There's a building that Delanus is in right now.
So cool.
Hop on that thing. It's about a 20-minute drive out to the pad. Get in the elevator, takes it up to 195 to the level. There's that white roof you saw just a minute ago. Now it's attached to the side of Atlantis. In fact, where I'm standing right here, right about there, right behind my shoulder is the hatch that leads into Atlantis. So that's how we climb into the spacecraft itself. Last seven folks we're going to see before launch get us into our seats. And there you see Rick in that commander seat, Lee in the pilot seat. Behind him are two other guys, Steve and Pat. You'll see them here in a little bit when we come home. They're all up on the flight deck, and actually for the last 2 hours, these guys up on the flight deck are actually very busy bringing all the systems up, making sure everything's checked out, making sure Atlantis is ready to fly. Danny and I are down on the mid deck. We're down below those guys, and we don't have anything to do for the last 2 hours, so we're just sort of laying there on our backs, just nice and quiet and kind of calm. And if you notice my eyes, they're sort of at half mast because shortly after this picture was taken, I fell asleep, according to Danny. He said I was out for about 45 minutes. But you do wake up for this bit right here. Now, I want to narrate a little bit of this so you get a feel for what it's like. So we've been on our backs now for a couple of hours listening to the countdown so we can hear everything going on. And as the count comes down, 10, 9, 8, 7, we get to 6 seconds, the three main engines now come to life. And when that happens, we can feel this rumble come up through Atlantis. You can see that in that little video right there. And then a count to 0, the solid rocket booster's light. That's like somebody kicking the back of your chair as hard as they can. So you can see it's a pretty rough ride in there initially. So the first 2 minutes and 17 seconds,
that's so cool.
We're going to ride those two solid rocket boosters attached to that big orange tank. At 12 seconds, we're going through 200 miles an hour, so we're moving pretty fast. And as you look backwards, if you watch, you'll see a sort of a cloud form around Atlantis. That's where we're going supersonic. We do that at right about 58 seconds. So from 0 to supersonic at 780 miles an hour, 1 minute. And as we continue to go uphill for 2 minutes and 17 seconds, we'll continue to accelerate with those two solid rocket boosters. That's going to get us up to about 150,000 feet. Do about 5 times the speed of sound, and then there's a flash and a bang, and away those things go. Now Atlantis is going to fly on those 3 main engines on our tail for the next 6.5 minutes until we get to orbit. We're going to be about 800 miles up the east coast, 122 nautical miles up, doing 17,500 miles an hour. Kick that external tank off, and now Atlantis is now not a rocket ship, but a spaceship. It should be in space
awesome.
In the next 2 weeks. So that 17,500 miles an hour is kind of a nice speed because it takes us
17,000 miles
every second. So
5 miles a second.
Welcome. So you guys have about 10 hours going back. Right, so you're going to hate this part. So from the standing stop right here at the beach to just south of London, 18 minutes. Folks from Australia, everybody here, Australia, welcome. So I know you guys really have it bad. It's at least 20 hours going back the other way. You're really going to hate this one. We go the long way around just because of the way we launch. So it takes us a little bit longer than it would otherwise. So it's 54 minutes. So we actually go around the planet in 93 minutes. That's one of the first big transitions you're going to have to make. And that is that the sun coming up and going down happen every hour and a half. And so that beginning and end of the day is not what the sun represents. It's just the time you turn your lights off and turn them back on. And you can get used to that. You'll see a sunset here in just a couple of minutes. The other thing is up and down. I'll talk to you about that when I go to work here in a bit. Now, on our last flight, we had sort of a neat day here in Florida, in that the upper level winds didn't exist. And so instead of tearing up our contrail, the ice crystals from our main engines, it stuck around. This picture was taken about 2 hours after launch. And that's what you see here.
Cool.
The contrail has sort of formed this neat little shape. They sent this picture up to us in our email the next morning. And I took a look at that, and if you look at it closely, you'll see what I saw. And that's that nice little shape over here on the right side. See that? So, of course, I saw that, turned around, sent it back to my wife, and told her I was leaving her a message on my way out of town. That worked great. Now, when we get to space and we get out of those orange suits, almost immediately, we're pretty much what we wear here, except no shoes, because we don't need them. Notice that this guy here, as he's heading back into the lab, no shoes, because we're not walking anymore, we're floating. That's actually very disorienting for a first-time spaceflight. Imagine when you enter into the lab, look at the other two people that are in there, look how they're oriented. Imagine seeing that every day, the first time. One upside down and the other one sideways. You give up drinking right at that point. Right, so But what that does is that now up is wherever your head is pointing and your feet are down, because we don't sense gravity like you and I sense it here. It's no longer there. Our middle ear doesn't tell us that way's down. So your brain has to come up with something different. That's what it does. It says, okay, that way is up, your head.
Her middle ear, never heard that.
There's your sunset of promise. Notice all the colors that we see spread out across the sky are compressed down into that little 60 miles of atmosphere that you and I live underneath. And all the colors are all right there, about 10 seconds worth, and then blank, it's gone. And then 45 minutes of darkness, and then 10 more seconds of color in the dark, in the sunrise, and then 45 minutes of bright white light. In fact, the sunlight in space is very bright and white. Not the yellow that you and I would color it here on the ground, because this color right here hasn't been filtered out by the atmosphere. So we get a very bright white light in space.
Pretty cool.
This is a rendezvous. We're actually doing a post separation fly around with the Russian space station mirror. And so there's that's me in the background with the yellow gold shirt or gold and blue shirt. There's right behind Solidjohn, there's another guy with the same shirt. His name's Joe Edwards. Mike Anderson swapping cameras with Terry Wilkett here in the front. And you'll see a shoulder and a hand pop up down here. That's Bonnie Dunbar. Six of us in the space of a small walk-in closet. In fact, your personal space shrinks to about 3 inches in orbit. So the moral of this little video is there's not much space in space. Get used to people being really close to you. But one of the cool things about it, though, it doesn't seem as bad as it might here on the ground, because we're not stuck to the floor. As you can see, I've floated up to the ceiling, literally, and you can use all three dimensions in space. So it actually doesn't seem anywhere near as crowded in space as it would here with the same number of people. Here you see me walking to work, and that suit, me and the equipment hanging off of me right here, is about 750 pounds. Really hard to move here on the ground, because that's weight. Of course, in space it has no weight, because we're in free fall. And so therefore, all I have to do is just move this thing around. It's got mass, you have to be careful how fast you're going. But outside of that, you can see what I'm doing right there. I'm just walking with my fingertips. That's all I have to do, just sort of reach out and gently grasp the handrail, pull gently, and then I float to wherever I want to go. And then get my work done. The other thing you'll notice is in the background, the Earth's horizon is upside down. In fact, we always put Earth that way here, because that's where down is. Earth is a reference to down. But of course, in space, as I mentioned earlier, my head is now up. So if I wanted to look at the Earth, I'd look up. What you're seeing here is the orbital sunrise. So the sun's just coming up on the planet, but it's already hitting the station where we're at right now. In fact, the front of my suit is about 250 degrees Fahrenheit. It's pretty hot. Backside of my suit is about minus 100 degrees Fahrenheit, so it's pretty cold. It's both hot and cold all at the same time. Primarily because there's no atmosphere to deal with there. Now, here's a view from being out on the arm. Imagine you're sitting in that suit. This I got a chance to do a couple of times. You get a couple of seconds where you can look down. The only thing between you and the Earth 250 miles away are your boots. That is a viewless moment. Here's what the S3S4 looks like now attached to the station. That's all of that piece right there. And so this is about 250 feet across. So that's a pretty big piece of equipment we left behind and put up there. And it delivers 25% of the power to the International Space Station. And that's what it looks like as we're flying away right there. Here's what it looks like now, assembly complete. Notice that there's four sets of panels. Right? So there's now four of them here. There's a shuttle attached. This thing is over 300 feet long, over 300 feet wide. Million pounds mass in orbit. It's the biggest, most complex spacecraft ever put in space. And we did it in 44 different pieces with 16 different countries and agencies. Most of those 44 pieces never saw each other on the ground. So the first time they ever came together was in space to build that. And it was done with people that spoke at least 12 different languages. So we have people from all over the place. And counting, Canadian English is one. Separate languages. But we have 16 different organizations that participated in this. This is an engineering marvel, if not a miracle. And it's up there in space so that we can have a research laboratory. It changes our knowledge in space, or we don't have to worry about this acceleration of gravity here because we're in free fall. We can get to understand the science better there, bring it back to the planet, and it changes the way we do things here. That's the whole reason it exists. And that's why we do all this research in space with NASA. Is really to push that edge of our envelope even further out. Here's what it looks like to go around the Earth. You're going to fly through the aurora borealis, the green lights in the atmosphere there. That's radiation coming from the sun, getting trapped by the magnetic field line, sent to the north magnetic pole. And now we're flying through it. And I got a chance to see this when I was outside doing a spacewalk. I saw the green glow coming over my shoulder. I saw this thing coming over my shoulder, and of course I was thinking about that, and I thought, well, that's the sun's radiation there, so in between, that's me, it's going through me, and I remember having this thought, and, well, I've had as many kids as I'm gonna have, so it's okay. Well, that was back when I had just 3 kids, I now have 5. And the younger two, outside of being a little larger and faster than their average kid, a few superpowers, they seem to be fine. So, alright, we're gonna come home, now we're gonna take a little bit of energy out of our orbit, just enough to hit the upper atmosphere at about 17,000 miles an hour, so we're gonna turn all that speed into heat. That's what you see right there, out at the very end, there's a little tiny dot, you probably can't see it, that's Atlantis coming home on her last mission just before she came over here where you can see her. And this is taken from the space station, and literally in the head of that meteor, where the shuttle is, this is what it looks like from the ground, there's Lee, we're back on a launch and entry suit, coming home, we're just done what we call a deorbit burn, I'll show you that in a second. And then here's what it looks like on wind tunnel, right there on the leading edge of the wing, and right there on the nose. Atlantis is seeing 2,700 degrees Fahrenheit.
Wow.
On steel, but of course, it's protecting us from that by the thermal protection system. Here's deorbit burn. Watch our little timer. See if we catch it. That's what we do. That's all it takes to get that energy out. Then we hit the upper atmosphere. So everything you see through those overhead windows right there, that flashing, that bright light, we're actually in the darkness. That's the atmosphere literally glowing white hot around us. And when the conditions are just right, you're going to see this little Mach meter here. It's going to click over to Mach 25, which says we just made 25 times the speed of sound. And when you do that, you get one of these nice little patches that I'm wearing right here. And it's kind of a big deal for us. And shortly after that, you start feeling the first sensations of gravity. And we're now in the daylight out front here. That's what you see out front. Now, we'll announce our arrival with two sonic booms. Since we're still supersonic,
that's so cool.
We're going to land. Not heating up the air anymore, but we're now supersonic. And so we plan to arrival, then we start a big right-hand turn. This is where the pilots start flying it by hand. And so we're going to line up with that runway you see there. It's a rectangle. And we're coming down about 6 times steeper than an airliner at this point. So we're coming down pretty much like a piano. Still, we get to about 1,200 feet. You'll see this little number here go to 1,200 feet. We start pulling the nose up, and now we start flying like a conventional airplane at this point. We're going to land right about there. And so at 500 feet, we'll drop the gear, and then we're now going to be flying pretty much like a 747 or an A380, just a little bit faster. And we'll touch down about 195 knots, about 215 miles an hour. And once the wheels touch, the next thing we do is pop the drag chute. Drag chute comes out, we roll to a stop, and then we give Houston a call, and that wheel stop call, we call it, is our official end of the mission. And that's how we get to that time right there, about 2 weeks, 220 laps around the Earth, another 5.8 million miles. And it's
holy cow.
So I've got about 18 million miles on my grid.
Wow.
Not a single one of them freaking wire mile. Now we get out, and this is actually very disorienting. We've been in space now for a couple of weeks. Our brain has gotten used to our heads being up, feet being down. That external sensor doesn't make sense. Well, now it does make sense. The brain starts looking at it, but it's not calibrated very well. So we actually feel a little disoriented right here where this picture was taken. But you notice we're not looking too disoriented because we're actually in Edwards Air Force Base, California, because that's a good news part of our story. There's also a bad news part. Normally, we'd like to land here at Kennedy Space Center, so we can just roll the land into the hangar and get ready for the next flight. All of our family and friends are waiting for us here. That's the bad news part. The good news part of this is that we're in Edwards Air Force Base, California, and there's 40 medical people that would normally be getting a hold of us for about 4 hours after we get out of the space shuttle and do a lot of nasty things to us. Those 40 people are here in Florida waiting for us, we're in California. So all those smiles right there, we're happy right there. Now, right after this, the picture was taken, which is also part of our smiles, is we were right over in the little town of Boron, California, having a Mexican food meal in a place called Domingo's. And there might have been a shot of tequila or two involved. Yeah, Atlantis is here, or you can see her. In fact, you can see her as the folks at Delmar North have put her on display here. They've done a magnificent job. And she's got her payload bay doors open. And that's something you never saw on the ground because they're actually quite flimsy. So you are going to see her, if you haven't seen her already, in the way that we saw her in space when we were outside doing a spacewalk. And that was the only time we could see her like that, where the payload bay doors open like this. You get a chance to see her. And definitely, if you haven't been there, plan on spending a couple hours in the building. It's pretty spectacular. Now, in the meantime, we're sending folks up on this thing. It's Russian Soyuz. In fact, this bit right here in the middle is where the folks are. These three people noticed that Tracy and two cosmonauts, their knees are literally in their chest. It's not a very comfortable environment. This is the only part that comes home. And as you watch that, notice that it's not a very comfortable ride on the way home. In fact, Peggy Whitson described this as pretty much a dust storm followed by a train wreck, you know, when you hit the ground and that thing. But they've been flying it since the 60s, and so it's a very robust vehicle, but it doesn't have a lot of bells and whistles to it. It's not designed for comfort. However, we are going to start flying this thing here pretty soon. This is called the Space Launch System. And it's going to be the replacement for the shuttle, which gets our exploration vehicles, which include the Orion, which you've seen out here in front of the gift shop, probably, where it's fully rotated. It's going to get us into space again and send us back to the moon and on to Mars. And that's the ultimate objective. And what we want to do is now take, for flying to the space station, we'd like one of these two companies, SpaceX or Boeing, to do those contracts. We're going to take this vehicle and start flying it off back to the moon or on to Mars. This is what a potential Mars vehicle might look like, where we have a couple of these,
that's cool,
these Orion vehicles that are now part of the ascent entry parts of the Martian vehicle, added to what looks like a space station. But this will be our habitat that we fly to Mars and then fly home, and it will probably look something like that. Now, we had one flight of the Orion. In fact, we got a second one coming up here later in the year, early next. And ultimately, we want to go here. Instead of 2 or 3 days on the surface, we want to spend 2 or 3 weeks to start building things that allow us to build that
FedEx.
Once we get used to doing that, it won't be very long before these guys start flying up there for us on a contract, right? So, but that's why we do this. We figure out how to do it, give it to the private sector, and now they start doing it. So, you want to go to Mars? It's about a 3-year-round trip to get there and back. In fact, to do that, we're going to have to figure out how to recycle 97% of everything we do. In fact, I guarantee you, already today, you've thrown away either in trash, materials of other sorts, and especially water, more than you could throw away on an entire 3-year mission. So that would be something we could use here on the ground in terms of recycling. Absolutely. Right? So that's one of the added benefits. Now, when we get designed for humans, we have to figure out what do we do well, and also, what sort of things can we screw up?
Forgot his key.
So there you have a little human engineering, and of course, you guys got a chance to see this launch today.
That was awesome.
It was pretty spectacular. It's on its way to the space station with Bruce Plot. So we'll be taking some,
Falcon 9.
Experiments up to the station and bring stuff back with that dragon that's going up right there. Thank you for joining us today. Really appreciated the opportunity to speak with you today. I hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you.